There's no one unique energy winner for future vehicles, but there's no doubt about it. The automobile industry is in a critical transition. To mitigate climate change and its damaging effects on the environment, the EU committed to achieve climate neutrality by 2050.
The European Green Deal is our new growth strategy.
Reaching this target requires urgent action by all our economic sectors, including the decarbonisation of the energy sector, to generate more sustainable means of transport. Let's explore some alternative power sources to decarbonise road transport. Transport is a major and growing user of energy that continues to produce negative external environmental costs. According to the European Commission, transport is responsible for nearly 30% of the total CO2 emissions in the EU, of which the majority comes from road transportation, which means cars, motorcycles, light and heavy trucks. Transport still relies heavily on fossil fuels. 91% of all the energy used in the road transportation sector comes from gasoline and diesel. It seems clear that it's necessary to develop alternative fuels. Several technologies, still under development, are in a worldwide competition to generate, transport and store energy for a cleaner urban mobility. Biodiesel, electricity, hydrogen, ethanol, natural gas, propane, etc. But what will the energy mix for urban road transport look like in 10-15 years?
On imagine en fait différentes hypothèses qui vont entre 50 et 60% en 2030 des véhicules qui vont être véhicules électriques à batterie, 100% batterie, et une part équivalente à entre 10 et 20% de véhicules hybrides rechargeables qui compléteront ces ventes. Donc dès 2030, 75% des véhicules vendus seront potentiellement capables de faire du zéro émission et d'avoir cette possibilité-là.
Indeed, electric vehicles may represent the future of low emission vehicles in the coming decades. But remember, more than 100 years ago, electrification almost became the dominant powertrain in transport. In 1920, 30% of cars were electric in Europe. Back then, the lead-acid batteries were very heavy and only allowing a short-range autonomy. 1 liter of gasoline was providing 10 times more energy than 1 kilogram of lead-acid battery. Electric cars had no chance to survive, and by the 1930s, they disappeared. And the number of cars burning fossil fuels increased rapidly. But today, electrification stands a good chance of breaking through for a variety of reasons.
En 1920, ça fait 100 ans, on avait beaucoup moins de voitures, on avait beaucoup moins de pollution et on ne parle pas de l'effet de changement climatique. Aujourd'hui, on parle de ça, on veut réduire l'émission de gaz à effet de serre et pour réduire ça, il faut utiliser des énergies renouvelables comme le soleil ou le vent. Et donc, la meilleure façon de stocker de l'énergie renouvelable dans la voiture, c'est la batterie. Elle a énormément progressé au niveau de la technologie. On peut aujourd'hui stocker beaucoup plus d'énergie dans une voiture et donc aller plus loin avec une batterie aujourd'hui qu'il y a 100 ans.
In 2020, more than 1 in 10 cars registered in the EU was electrically chargeable. Affordability remains a major barrier to consumers, but electronics have come a long way since 1920. Today, there are small, high-performance components available that can help to make the electric car more affordable and efficient.
L'électronique qui est aujourd'hui dans la voiture est basée sur des semi-conducteurs. C'est une technologie récente. Elle a énormément évolué. Elle nous permet aujourd'hui de réduire la taille et le poids des organes qui font la propulsion de la voiture. Donc, on a besoin de moins de batteries. Donc, en gros, la voiture, elle est plus légère, elle va plus loin, elle est plus efficace, elle est moins chère, donc abordable pour tout le monde.
There's still a lot to do to reduce the environmental footprint from well to wheel of an electrical powertrain and its battery. But the electric vehicles are rising in popularity. This trend can strongly be supported by governments by investing in infrastructure and putting in place sustainable incentives. It is a well-known fact that Norway is a global leader in electric vehicle adoption, with close to 90% of all new cars powered by some type of electric technology. So how did a relatively small, all-rich country manage to accomplish such large EV adoption?
The package of EV incentives is developed for almost 30 years. The intention of these EV incentives is to introduce and to promote emission-free vehicles into the Norwegian market. Over the years, the incentives are gradually introduced by different governments and also broad coalitions of parties, all to speed up the transition. The most important of these incentives are the tax exemption from the buying of a new car and the yearly road tax. Also, VAT is exempt. You have access to the toll roads, to ferries, municipal parking, and also to the bus lanes. At the moment, we have 330,000 EVs in the Norwegian car market. This is 10% of the car population. The Norwegian Parliament has decided that as of 2025, all new cars sold, except for trucks, will be emission-free vehicles running on battery or hydrogen.
Now, let's talk about fuel cell electric vehicles. Just like the all-electric ones, these vehicles use electricity to power an electric motor. The difference is that fuel cell electric vehicles produce electricity using a fuel cell powered by hydrogen, rather than drawing electricity from a battery only. Hydrogen is probably the most anticipated technology to get to net zero, especially green hydrogen produced from renewable energy sources, such as wind power, solar power, or biomass. Hydrogen-powered vehicles only emit water, and filling up on hydrogen is just as quick as refueling with gasoline. It just takes a few minutes to inject it in the form of pressurized gas, and the vehicle is then able to cover at least 400 kilometers. This is a huge advantage, especially for taxi fleets or heavy mobility like trains, bus or boats. Today, green hydrogen is still expensive to generate, transport and use. This is no different to any new technologies as they come to market. Cost is almost always the greatest initial hurdle. But how can we encourage the introduction of hydrogen?
Une fois qu'on a mis en place en fait cette énergie décarbonée, qu'on a proposé des produits de mobilité qui eux permettent le roulage zéro émission pour passer à la neutralité carbone et qu'on soit certain que les clients en fait aient une acceptabilité, il va falloir avoir une couverture d'infrastructures, de bornes de recharge, de points d'avitaillement qui soient suffisants pour que les gens puissent aller d'un point à un autre sans avoir de contraintes particulières dans leur mobilité. Et donc ça veut dire qu'il faut que l'État, la Commission européenne, accompagne le déploiement de l'électricité et de l'électricité à hydrogène avec les infrastructures qui sont nécessaires.
Developing all these key technologies in the next years will have a decisive impact on our future and could help lower carbon dioxide emissions. Public actions and incentives are essential. But to achieve clean mobility, we need all European engineering experts in road transport to cooperate with the energy sector. Finally, we should not forget that to reduce our emissions fast enough, the decarbonisation of the world's vehicle fleet cannot be separated from a better integration of active and shared mobility. But this will be the topic of another video. Thank you for watching this video. If you want to know more about urban mobility and its challenges, check out the different online courses of the EIT Urban Mobility Academy. Link in the description below.